businesses? We're actually watching really, really, let's see if I can record it. So this is actually the subject of today's lecture, which is transgenics. So transgenics, they're going to be organisms that have DNA that's from a foreign source, and that foreign source is usually us, in that, not our own DNA, but DNA that we've engineered and put into that organism. So what this is an embryo where every time you see a flash of red, that's a cell dividing. So it went from just a few cells to a lot of different cells. And this is actually going to form a vertebrate that's going to form a zebrafish. So it's a little bit out of the time here. But you can kind of see this stripe going through here, and that's going to be like the long axis of the fish. So the cool thing about transgenics is that we're going to look at how we can manipulate DNA and put it into organisms, and then what it lets us do, like watch all of these cool things that happen during development. Okay, so I just like that movie. So let's get into what transgenics are. So I mentioned them on Monday already, the idea that we're going to spend the rest of the class actually looking at how we can manipulate DNA in various different ways to change the DNA of an organism. So we're going to be doing technology that started maybe 20 years ago in how we're going to replace genes in mice. And then next week, we're going to move into CRISPR technology, which is a newer technology, but still we're going to be changing the DNA of organisms for better or worse. So the idea is just we're going to be able to put DNA into these different organisms, and we have to think about why do we want to do that. And so the motivation here, and hopefully this comes from some of the things we've been talking about in class, so often the motivation for manipulating things has to do with creating therapies or testing therapies. Also come from one of the things that comes out of classical genetics, which is that we identify genes that are associated, or alleles of genes that seem to be associated with diseases, and we'd like to know for sure whether or not that DNA, that gene, the DNA associated with that gene, if that truly is associated with the disease, because it helps us think about therapies, and it also really confirms that we've actually identified the right gene and we're not spending our time working on the wrong gene. So, confirming that the gene that we identified as potentially being interesting or causative for disease is in fact the gene. And we can also learn where genes become, where genes actually need to be active, and I'll come back to that a little bit later. So that's the motivation for why we're going to be looking into making transgenics, and the next thing is how do we do it? Okay, so the methods are how are we actually going to incorporate DNA into organisms? And so last Monday, we started talking about how do you get DNA into organisms, and the answer could be, it depends a little bit on the organism. If you've got something like bacteria or yeast, a microorganism, you can actually just put them under intense stress, so electrocute them or put them under heat shock, and they'll actually take up DNA from their surroundings. But other animals, you either have to inject that DNA physically, or what we went through was how you do this in a mouse. So we're going to keep using mice as a test system for how we get DNA into organisms, and then what kind of DNA we want to manipulate. So the purpose of this course, we're not going to teach you the very fine details about how to manipulate DNA and actually get it into different organisms and change them. We're thinking more conceptually, what kinds of things do we want to use our knowledge about DNA and about organisms, what kind of things do we want to change, what kind of things can we change? So I'm actually just going to write this on the board because I think it'll make sure that I get all the parts rather than showing it to you on a slide. But last Monday, what we talked about was if you wanted to get DNA into a mouse, it was actually a really, I think, amazing thing that we can actually take a mouse. So we have a, I'm gonna color code these, okay? So let's say our motivation is we've identified a gene that's interesting, we think it's interesting to us in mice, let's say it causes deafness in mice. We want to know, one, did we identify this piece of DNA where we saw a mutation? Did we identify the right gene? And what else can we learn about this? So let's say we start with a mouse. And this mouse has a mutation in a gene, and this causes hearing loss. Okay, so. Okay, so we've got a phenotype, and we've got a mouse, and let's say this is a receptor gene. We'll call it, this is actually a gene name that I'm stealing from a fruit fly gene, but we'll use this. So, atonal, can't hear tone. And we'll call this mutant allele A, little a, recessive allele. So this mouse has this genotype. And what we'd like to know is this mutation in a gene, is this really causal of this phenotype of not being able to hear? Okay? So we want to replace that little a, we'd like to replace it with a wild type version of that gene. And what we're going to do is manipulate the DNA so that's possible. Okay? So how do we actually do that? So we need another mouse. Which also has the same phenotype. So we're going to make these mice together. They're going to make, so we have a sperm and an egg. Those come together. We have a little fertilized egg. And kind of like that movie, in the very first parts of life, that divides lots of times. And we have something where we've got a bunch of cells. So somewhere around 300 cells. Okay. What's really remarkable, this is work from lots of people over many years, is that we can actually take cells out of that embryo, put them into a dish, grow them up, change the DNA in them, and then put them back into a mouse. Okay, so let me walk through what we're going to do there. So we take these cells out, put them in a petri dish. These are called ES cells or embryonic stem cells. And now they're just little groups of cells. One cell that sits on this dish, and there's lots of nutrients in the dish, so the cells like to divide and will become a little colony of cells, and you can see with your eye, there's just 100 cells in there. So now we can add in DNA that we've engineered. Let me actually change my marker here. We'll go through, again, several different ways, the types of DNA that you want to add to this. So we're going to get that DNA into the cells. Okay, we want to know, so the set of things to keep track of. We want to engineer the DNA. So we've created this new set of, this new piece of DNA in the lab. And we want to make sure it got into those cells. So what we want to keep track of is, did our cells receive the DNA that we engineered? Okay. So we're going to make some DNA that's associated with a gene. So I'll diagram this like this. So here's a double-stranded piece of DNA. We've talked about genes where we've got a coding region. Maybe there's an exon. Intron, another Exxon. And then a regulatory region to allow that gene to be expressed. And then, in order to make sure that we know that this DNA got into those cells, we're also going to add on something else. It's another part of that same DNA, and this is going to be something that we're calling NeoR. What this is DNA that when we transcribe it and translate it into protein, it allows that cell to be resistant to an antibiotic. Okay? So we've got these cells in a dish, and we've added DNA. It's actually not so easy to get DNA into these cells. That DNA also has to get into the chromosome. So if we think about this mouse, so we take a cell from this mouse. If we looked at one of those cells, and we look in the nucleus of that, and then we've got chromosomes. It's not enough chromosomes per mouse, but that's all I'm going to draw. And we say, okay, so this mouse is homozygous for this mutant allele. What we'd like to do is provide somewhere this DNA here that has a version of the functional gene. Okay, so what we want to do is inject into this, we somehow want to get in DNA that we've made that has the normal gene. So what is that going to look like as a diagram? Got our regulatory region, we've got our coding region of A, and then we've got this bit with the antibiotic. So we want that to go in there. So we know that it's gotten in there because now we're going to treat these cells with the antibiotic. All the cells that didn't get the DNA are going to die. The only ones that live are the ones that took up this DNA. Okay. So we've got some DNA that we engineered. We've gotten it into these cells. Now we've got cells in a dish. That's fabulous, but that's not a mouse. So we then have to do a little in vitro fertilization here, kind of. So we take these cells with our engineered DNA. Let me keep color coding these. So these are our cells with the engineered DNA. So they've got that genotype of here with a mutant. I guess I've switched colors on us here, but. And hopefully they've got the DNA having that new allele. How do we grow a mouse out of this? Well, we get two other mice that look different. So we're going to use ones with different coat colors. We don't actually yet have blue mice, but that's okay. Okay, so we're going to get them together. They're going to produce a little embryo. That's going to have a bunch of cells in it. We're going to mix with a very, very small needle these cells into this young embryo. Okay, so this embryo is going to be made up of two types of cells. It's going to be made of these blue cells from these parents, and then these red cells that have the engineered DNA. Okay, so that embryo gets implanted into a female mouse. And she carries that along with all of her other normal embryos, so she's a foster mother, or a surrogate mother, sorry. So then we're gonna get a mouse out of this, and that mouse is going to have these two different types of cells in it. How do we know which cell is which? Well, in the case, so what else do we want to keep track of? We need to keep track of the DNA. We need to keep track of the cells that have that engineered DNA. So did our cells that have that that new house. And we can do that because we use something, another marker, in this case a coat-color marker, to be able to tell that there, if we ever see something that, that is representative of this red color, then we know the cells are in there. And so what you'd expect is that we get a little mouse out of here, where some parts of that mouse would be blue, and that's from the cells. So cells contribute to different parts of the organism. Some of those cells are going to be the blue ones, and some of those cells are going to be the red ones with engineered DNA. So now I've got a mouse, and this is called a chimera or a mosaic. It's made of two different types of cells. They're different in a couple of ways. So these red ones have the mutant allele plus the DNA in them. Maybe these are just from a normal wild type animal, but maybe they also have the, we don't know about the genotype of these. So we could choose animals that also have that mutation, or maybe they're like this. But in any case, there are differences between the two cells. So now we've got this mouse, and there's, it's going to be kind of confusing to try to figure out, did we substitute, when we put in this DNA with the big A, did that complement, did that fix did it provide the information that was missing when we had those little A alleles? It's a little hard to tell in this guy because it's got some cells from one genotype and some cells from another. So we can make this one so we will get another blue mouse. So what's important here is that we've got some kind of marker. It's dominant, something we can see. So we're going to make this chimeric mouse. It should be all blue. Now, if the engineered cells made it into the germline and became the sperm or the egg, then this animal can pass that engineered cell down. So if, so this one, let's say this is the mother, this could make eggs that are derived from these red cells, or it can make eggs that are derived from blue cells. These would have our engineered DNA that we want, these don't. If we look at what kind of babies come out of this cross, these are all going to make sperm that are blue. We say this is something dominant that we can see. We're either going to see little baby mice that are blue because they're from this egg, the blue one, or we're going to have little baby mice that are completely red, because they came from this one. So if we have a completely red mouse here, then we know that it got the DNA. So the third thing we need to keep track of is, so did our DNA get in? Did our cells get to be part of this? And then do we now have inheritable transgenics? In here. Okay, and so we'd see that when we have this marker where the entire mouse is echoed. So this is the scheme. We're actually going to be using it over and over again.
Yep. Does this only work when it's a loss of function mutation?
So you're asking a really, really good question. In terms of how we can monitor all these things, we don't need a loss of, so all of these things is going to be the same whether we've got a loss or gain of function mutant. But this first part of can we complement a mutant by putting in something new, that only works with a loss of function. Yeah, good question. Okay, so we're going to be going through a couple of different things. We'll actually be talking about those loss of function mutations, what we do if we've got a dominant mutation that we might want to test if that's the right gene. Okay, so this is the big scheme on the board. And that's a blank slide. And this was to just show you my drawing in a mouse. There's a stage where the mice have patches that have are derived from each one of the parents. And it's in this scheme, it's a little bit confusing. But it actually told us something that's kind of interesting, which is we have ways of making animals where some of the cells have one genotype and other cells have a different genotype. And that's actually going to be very useful because we can harness that in a more controlled way to figure out where is the gene actually required within an organism. And this becomes really important because there are some genes, so maybe something involved in hearing loss is only found in the ear, and we'll learn that. But there are other genes that are actually expressed, transcribed in all the cells in the body, but they have different roles in different parts of the body. So maybe if you want to study something about how the heart works, the heart is going to be signaling, it's going to receive information from other parts of the body. It might have genes in there, something like myosin. This is a motor protein that helps the muscles move. You might want to be able to manipulate that just in the heart and not all the other muscles, et cetera, et cetera. So we're going to learn a little bit about how to engineer things so that not all the cells have the same bits. So how do we start doing that? So going back to something from lectures in the early part of class is that there are lots of genes. Genes have coding regions. Genes have regulatory regions. Those regulatory regions determine where and when a gene is turned on, where and when we transcribe RNA from that, and when that RNA is made into protein. So we can, so this is gene A. Gene B or gene C, each one of them has some unique regulatory region. And maybe this is a regulatory region that the information there says turn on in the eye. And maybe the regulatory region here says turn on everywhere, it'll be active everywhere. And what we're going to talk about in the next bit is that you can actually mix and match different parts of genes. So normally a gene has its own regulatory region and its coding region, but you can actually swap one for the other. And that'll become useful in a little bit. So with these coding regions, so every gene has its own coding region, but we can actually swap out. So if we want to know, here I said, here's a regulatory region that makes this gene only be transcribed in the eye. Well, how do we know that? And the way that we can learn that is if we take this regulatory region, so this piece of DNA, and we substitute its coding region with some kind of visible marker. Sometimes this is called a reporter. And that visible reporter is something that we can see, and it will tell us where that gene is actually expressed. Okay. So I've left this on kind of all the slides just to remind myself and you that we're talking about how we're going to make DNA. We always need to put in this thing that allows us to keep track of it and know that it's gotten into cells. Okay, so if we want to make a reporter or know where a gene is normally transcribed, we take that regulatory region. So say that get from DNA. We take DNA from a reporter, and so a reporter is often something that you can actually see with our eyes. And a very, very typical thing is something called green fluorescent protein. Apparently, I think it's so important I can do this in all caps. So, GFP. And then, of course, we would have to make sure that our little neo-R is attached to this. Okay, so why do we really like this as a reporter? So this is going to let us know where that regulatory gene or regulatory region is acting. Okay, so what is GFP? GFP, it's a protein. It forms this funny little barrel. It's actually isolated from jellyfish, and jellyfish glow in the ocean. So is that jellyfish. There are also corals that grow or that glow in the red. So you can actually, so these are proteins in test tubes, and they, if you hit them with the right wavelength of light, they'll glow. And we can incorporate these into living organisms, and we can see different things within them. So this is just a couple of examples in different organisms. If we engineer bacteria with green fluorescent protein, they'll glow. This is a C. elegans worm, this is a fruit fly, this is bunny, these are mice. And we can tell, we've used different regulatory regions in these different examples. So in some cases, I don't know if we're going to work on this background, but so this would tell us that the regulatory region for this gene is everywhere. And actually, we call these ubiquitous, so they're genes that are everywhere. This is an example where that's not everywhere. Those are just outlining, I think it's the, actually I don't know what part of the worm that is, but anyway, it's not all the cells in the worm, otherwise you just see a tube. It's some of the cells in the out, somewhere in a worm. Okay, so this is telling, it's giving us a report of where that gene is become active. Now that just tells us where the regulatory region, where that attracts the RNA polymerase, but it doesn't tell us about the protein. So proteins are, so that gene is going to encode in this coding region here. It's going to encode a protein, and the protein's going to do something in the cell. So maybe it sits in the nucleus and changes how the DNA gets regulated. Maybe it sits at the surface of the cell and interprets signals. So it'd be nice to know not only which cells does the regulatory region turn on in, but where does the protein that's used, where does that go? So again, we can use GFP as a way of telling where that goes. And so this is something else that I wanted to, again, with this idea of engineering, we can make a fusion between a normal protein. So here's, so again, this is the DNA. Remember, when we make RNA, so actually I should do it with this one, where we've got some introns. So if we've got a gene, introns, we're going to make RNA from here. That's going to be processed so that we are missing those little bits here. So we're going to remove these. And then we're going to translate that into protein. Okay, so we'd like to be able to follow this protein. We can do that by adding in the amino acids that would be part of GFP. The way that we do that is we just, so this is all going to work together as long as we make an RNA that has the RNA for the GFP information here. So if we add the DNA sequence, it just reads it as one long thing. So it's going to read the DNA sequence for the gene and the GFP that we're adding. That reads it all into the RNA, gets processed, and makes one long protein. And so one of the things we need to do is remember at the end of genes, there's usually a stop codon. So that would say that as you're reading the RNA, you would stop and not make any more protein. So we have to get rid of that. And then we just start with the GFP information. So that was a lot of information. You have questions on that? Yeah?
On the images, which is the first question, what causes it to be expressed in certain areas?
In certain areas. So the reason it was expressed only in certain areas is it turned out the regulatory region, the specific regulatory region that we chose related to one gene, that was the information to only have it turn on in certain cells was there. I'll show you an example of a couple of slides that might help with that too, because it actually kind of writes it out. So we'll slide for that. Yeah.
So in this case, is the GFP like connected to the rest of the protein for that?
So the GFP is it's connected. So you make the protein, and the protein will fold in some way. The GFP is kind of dangling off the end. For this class, we're just going to say go ahead and add GFP. If you're doing this for real, you can imagine that a protein that has a bit of extra stuff dangling off the end might not work normally, and so you have to play around with how to engineer it. Yeah?
What does the NEO-R do?
So the NEO-R, this is our marker that lets us, so this is this piece of DNA that encodes, so let me just write it out. So NEO-R is going to be a little, so it's a DNA level cassette that has two parts to it. So it has a NEO resistance coding region, and it has a ubiquitous everywhere promoter or regulatory region. And this little thing, when it's attached to your DNA, is going to provide this other information to let you know that cells have incorporated your DNA. So if we want to make sure that cells, where are we? So here, when we're doing this and we're saying we engineered some DNA, we want to make sure it got into these cells. How do we know it got in there? By including that little bit, it tells us that if we provide these cells with an antibiotic, most of the cells are going to die. The only ones that are going to live are the ones that have that little DNA in there. Okay, so it's serving as a way that we just know that the thing we engineered got to where we wanted it. You don't need to know too much more information about how that works, but you can look it up if you want to know exactly the mode of action.
Why do we use NEO-R in this class as opposed to other types of antibiotics?
Okay, so this is a question about why do we use NEO-R instead of another type of antibiotic resistance. I'm giving you one example, and so in mice, it's a very commonly used drug. If you're doing something else, you might use a drug called tigermycin or tunicomycin. There's lots of different drugs, and it really depends on what organism you're working with. Sometimes we want to have multiple ones. But they all, in some ways, for the purposes of what we're doing now, they work the same in that it's a piece of DNA we add so that we can see that something, the DNA got to where we wanted it to go.
So,
one copy of Big A, yes. Okay, so that's actually great, so I can draw it on here. So when we get, so we are, it's a little bit of a numbers game. It's very, very inefficient. The process of getting DNA into cells, it's like 1 in 10,000 of them actually pick up the DNA that we get. So most likely what's happened is the DNA that we engineered is going to end up somewhere on some chromosome and one copy of it. And so that's why it's going to end up being just one big A. But it's actually, that's actually raises another point that's going to become important, is that right now we're saying we're going to add DNA into these cells. We don't really know where it goes into which chromosome. We just know it's gotten into some chromosome. So It's not replacing these, it's just going in somewhere. And typically one copy.
And so it's not replacing like the whole segment, it's like adding on.
So from what I've talked about today, so far, it's just adding on. Yeah, and this kind of comes back to your question about, can we do this with a dominant mutation? So if these A's were dominant and we added in some other DNA, wild type DNA, wouldn't really work. So right now we're going to talk about adding. Later on we'll talk about replacing. Okay, so we're going to, this now is an example of how we're going to not only know where a gene is transcribed, where it's active, but the protein that it makes, where that goes in the cell. So, and here, I actually just took data from my lab. Can you see this? Or should I turn off the, so you can kind of see it. So this is actually a leaf. And the outlines of all the cells are marked in a color. So we can, so what we're looking at here is there's one gene, and it's in all of the cells. So every cell is red. So that regulatory region means that we learn from taking the regulatory region of that gene that that's everywhere. And the protein goes to the edge of the cell. Now we've got some green and blue dots in here. Actually, I'm going to turn off the boards for a second. So we've got some green dots and some blue dots. Those are actually the nuclei of the cells. And so what we learned there is that the protein goes to the nucleus, not to the edge of the cell. But the regulatory region of the green one went to certain cells, and the regulatory region of the blue one went to different cells. Turns out we know that the green ones here are stem cells. They're going to divide lots of times and make lots of progeny. And these blue ones are cells that are committed to becoming a certain type of cell. So the reason that people, so you can see a little bit about where a gene is active and where in the cell the protein goes. And the reason that people like GFP is that it is something that you can have a living organism and you can watch what's happening. So this is something where this leaf is growing, and then actually see it better on the next slide. So you might not care about leaves, but I do. And again, it's kind of dim, but the movie that you saw at the beginning of class too, we have ways that we can watch while something is growing or responding. We can see where the genes turn on and where they turn off, where the proteins go. So this is what a lot of people use engineering of DNA for, is to be able to watch genes being active within organisms. So these are about reporters, and the two types of reporters that I mentioned. We've got one where we've substituted the coding region of the gene for the GFP. And so this tells us where is the gene transcribed. Where is RNA transcribed? And that's because we're using the regulatory region. If we keep the coding region in, and we have GFP, and this is actually in response to the question over here, you know, how does this hang off of the protein? So, you know, maybe we tried it here and it kind of messes things up, so we had to move it over here. We can move the GFP around. But this is something that tells us, these are reporters that tell us where is the RNA transcribed and where does the protein made from that, where in the cell does that go? And then this is for the question that was up in the front about the different kinds of reporters. So this is the head of a worm. And And this is an example of people who did one of each of those types of reports. So here is the regulatory region. This is just says how long it is, 2.6 kV or 2,600 bases long. And then just GFP, and that is in some neurons in the head. The neurons kind of have this structure, so they've got a long process and then the body and then another process and branches. And if we just look at GFP, GFP is a molecule that floats around all over the cell. And so you kind of see it in this blob, which is this blob. But if we put the protein in there, now it ends up in these long stripes, and that's this part. Okay, so this is telling us whatever information's in here, the DNA information in there says only get turned on in the neurons, don't get turned on in the muscles, don't get turned on in the gut. And then this, if we include the protein, it tells us turn on the neurons, but then go to a particular part of the neuron, okay, this part, rather than just floating around. Okay, so lots of people do these experiments. Lots of people ask where their genes become active. And so because of that, people built this toolkit where they said, this piece of DNA tells me that when I include this piece of DNA, that means that gene, anything behind that, that gene's going to be turned on just in the eye, or just in the skin, or just at a certain time in cell cycle. Remember we talked about cells divide, they go through a phase, they duplicate their DNA, S phase, and they go on. We can just turn on a gene at that stage. There's some times that we know if you deprive an animal of oxygen, or a plant of oxygen, there'll be a response, and some genes get turned on. It's usually an emergency response. So we can take the DNA from those genes and say, okay, if we want to deprive an animal of oxygen, these genes are going to turn on. And if we can get GFP to turn on, we can get something else to turn on. So there's lots of regulatory parts, and then there are coding parts. There are all the genes that we're interested in, but we could also use these to manipulate organisms. So here I showed you some examples. In the very beginning, that was a movie where the protein that you saw in those little dots was marking the chromosomes, so you could see the chromosomes. The movie that I just showed you of the leaf, we had a protein that ended up in the plasma membrane, so all around the outside. Maybe we want to actually make some cells send a signal. We can make them express a ligand for a particular signal. We're going to hear about recombinase in a moment. This is actually a protein that makes, you heard about from Professor Simon, in meiosis, we have our chromosomes get together and they can recombine. So that process of taking DNA and recombining it, we're actually going to use that. We get GFP. And so it's a mix and match. You can take a regulatory region and a coding region, put them together, and we can do all sorts of really interesting things in organisms. So for this first part, I already mentioned the transgenic, we talked about a complementation test. So the thing that we did was we added in DNA with one of the goals being we're going to put some DNA in and see whether or not it complements a mutant. That mutant has to be recessive for this to work. And the mosaic is that not all cells in an organism have the same DNA. That's what we saw those chimeric. These guys. We can kind of mimic that by engineering something so that it's only turned on in certain cells. And maybe today, maybe on Monday, I'll talk to you about a really cool technique that lets you remove a gene from only certain cells. Okay, so everything that I talked about before is that DNA is randomly integrating. And the question up here was, the comment up here was, well, maybe does it go into the same place as the original gene? So we're going to move now into how, it's useful sometimes to not just add it someplace else, but instead we may want to have a situation where we've replaced it. takes a little bit of extra stuff. Okay, so we're going to learn now how to replace a gene rather than just adding in DNA. So adding in DNA is the first step. A lot of this replacing is going to be the same, but there'll be a couple added bits to it as well. So there's how do we do it, and then why do we want to do it? And so, I'll let you guys think about this for a moment. So why might we want to replace the DNA instead of just adding? One of the things that was already brought up was that if we've got a dominant mutant, if we want to complement that, if we want to see if we've identified the right DNA, we can't just add it, it doesn't work. So if we have a dominant mutant that we want to ensure that we have the right DNA for that gene, we need to do this. So if we've got a dominant mutant, do you think of any other reasons why we want to replace the DNA?
Maybe it's dangerous to have too many copies of it.
Okay, so maybe it's dangerous to have too many copies. So that's definitely an idea that you might want to not have extra versions of it floating around. So we'll call that the control copy number. Any other ideas? So what we started with here at the beginning was, let's say we started with a mutant and we wanted to fix it. But back when Professor Simon was talking, we talked about lots of human diseases, right? And we're not going to manipulate humans, or we'll talk about that a little bit next week. But we often want to make a mouse model. So we say, this gene seems to be important in humans. Let's see if we eliminate that gene or disrupt that gene in a mouse. Are we going to get the same symptoms? And if we do, we can start to use that as a disease model. So we might start with a wild-type mouse, and maybe we want to disrupt it. This is often called a gene knockout. We're going to disrupt it and eliminate the function of that gene. So we might want to create a mutant allele. So maybe we want to completely disrupt the gene. But sometimes we don't want to completely disrupt the gene. Maybe, again, from a GWAS study or something else, we know there's a certain type of allele that's associated with the disease. So maybe we can make a mouse model where we just tweak an allele. We just change a few bases, maybe a few amino acids. So maybe we want a very special type of allele. I'm going to call this mimicking a disease allele. Really common reasons that we might want to replace something. So we might want to get rid of something that's dominant and confusing us, so we want to replace that. We might actually want to replace something that's dominant because it's causing the disease and replace that with something that's wild type. Or we might want to create a new mutant in a very precise place. Okay, so how do we do this? Well, I'll tell you the first part of it is exactly the same as what I did on the board in terms of getting DNA from different places. So I'm going to walk through this pretty quickly because because that's exactly what I talked about there. So we have two mice. They have some kind of way of, so they're wild-type mice. They've got some kind of coat color, something that we can tell cells came from them. They produce an embryo. We take cells from that embryo, put them in a dish. We add our DNA. We tell that we've been able to add the DNA, and the DNA has been incorporated, because then we put the antibiotic in. Everything else dies. Only the cells that have our DNA are there. We combine those cells. Then we get another pair of mice that are a different color here, so we can tell them apart. They have a baby. We take their embryo. We combine cells that we engineer with those cells, put them into a mouse. It has babies that are multiple colors. We cross those, and then we get these. So this is exactly the same. No matter what we're doing, that's the same scheme of getting DNA into the mouse. What's going to be different is the type of DNA that we're going to put in the mouse. Okay, and so what's going to happen now? So first, we just said whatever piece of DNA we want, we're going to engineer it in. We're going to make sure there's this little mycin thing so that it's resistant to antibiotics. But other than that, any sequence you want to put in, go for it. This time, we're going to replace it. And one of the things that we're going to use is this process of homologous recombination. This is basically exactly what happens normally in chromosomes in meiosis. Okay, so the same basic process. Really important here is that homologous chromosomes have enough similarity in their DNA sequences that they can find each other. Okay, so we're gonna require, I'll come back to this, we're gonna require that there's some similarity in the DNA sequences. GFP, this wonderful marker that lets us see things, doesn't look like anything else in the mouse. So if we want to get GFP to a particular place with this method, we need to include some information that looks just like a chromosome. So let's go back to those chromosomes. So this is, I don't know where I took this diagram from, but. So in the process of meiosis, you've got two chromosomes, call them blue and pink. They're similar enough to each other that they can find each other in pair, and they'll actually break and rejoin, and then you've got this crossover. Okay, so that's what you had when you did a lot of mapping. So if we imagine these are chromosomes, so it's the same process, except for here we'll imagine this is the chromosome. And this is going to be our engineered DNA. And what we're going to be looking for is actually two crossovers, two recombination events, where we're going to break both the chromosome and our DNA. Engineered DNA. And essentially what we're going to want to create is a chromosome that has our engineered DNA replacing where the normal one was. Okay, so this is what we want to set up. We want to set up a situation where the cell says, oh, yeah, let's do recombination right here, and take in this new DNA and replace our normal chromosome DNA at exactly the right place. So what do we need for this? We need, so homologs, homology, homologous recombination. We're gonna engineer our DNA. What we have to include in this is something that we're gonna call a homology arm. And that's DNA on the sides of the engineered bit that looks enough like the chromosome that it's going to find a place in the chromosome. couple of arms because they're going to be one on each side. Okay, so let's look a little bit more closely at that DNA that we're going to engineer. So we're going to need these arms. We still need to have the selectable marker. We still need to make sure that we can follow our DNA. But the problem with this marker is this also doesn't look like anything in a mouse chromosome or your chromosome or a fruit fly chromosome. So this, if we put this in alone, this is going to randomly go somewhere in the chromosome. We have to target it to a particular region. So if we've got a region of a chromosome, and we've got our gene that we're interested in, so we've got a regulatory region for our gene, we've got a coding region with a couple of introns, a couple of exons. That's, I guess, the important part of the gene. We're going to make something that is engineered. Maybe our engineered bit includes the regulatory region. So this is a case where the DNA is going to match. Okay, so but maybe we want to replace this gene with something I just showed you, GFP. Okay, so if we want to replace that gene with GFP, GFP doesn't match, right? That's something new. So it's not going to match the coding region at all. And if we want to include that NEOR to be able to see something, or to be able to track our DNA, that also doesn't match. Okay? So what we need to have is, on the other side, we need to include some sequences. That's our homology arm here. That have to match the DNA that we're targeting to. So it turns out that with enough, this happens infrequently. We need to play around with a couple of tricks to make this happen efficiently. But essentially, cells are able to do homologous recombination if we make the conditions well enough. What they're going to need is regions that look like a chromosome. We're actually providing usually a lot of DNA, so it's going to like to do this. So regions that are similar enough, and then we can substitute a normal gene with something else. So it's actually going to replace it. So how long do these regions have to be? Kind of varies a little bit, but usually about 1,000 bases is enough for cells to recognize, hey, this DNA sequence looks like something on my chromosome. I can consider this for homologous recombination. So this is the kind of thing that we've talked about before, but now we need to pay attention to making sure that the edges of whatever we engineer looks just like the chromosome, that where we want it to go. Okay. So I'll move on to the next bit and then maybe pause a little bit for questions, because I think the next bit's a little bit linked. So again, let's look a little bit closer at what we're engineering. And I mentioned before this NEOR marker. Remember, it's got something, so promoter or regulatory region, something that makes it turned on all the time, and the coding region so that we can always be resistant to an antibiotic. but this doesn't look like something in your chromosome normally. If our goal, so I mentioned one of the things that we like to do is make a disruption of the gene. We can kind of do two things at once. We can target a gene that we're interested in, and we can substitute the normal coding region of that gene with a coding region, an exon of the coding region of a gene. We can engineer something that has this neomycin little cassette in the middle of it. At the end of this, at the end of the coding region, there's always a stop codon. And so, if you've got a gene, normally we, after you make the RNA from it, and you translate it to protein, you have to go in order on that RNA. If we've introduced something like this, with a stop codon in it, it means that that gene is no longer going to be made correctly. The protein from that gene is no longer going to be made correctly. So you'll make RNA here. That RNA is going to include the sequences here. And when you try to read that, when that RNA, here, you'd make RNA for that exon. And then it would be translated into protein. And here, you'd make slightly longer RNA because we've added some extra sequences in here. And we'd start making protein. We'd start making this other protein, this NeoR protein. But then when we stop making the, at the end of that NeoR protein, it's going to be a stop. And so we're not going to make the rest of the protein of the normal gene, right? So that's going to disrupt that gene. So this is a nice trick that we use to say, let's both destroy the function of a gene and be able to tell that we destroyed the function of the gene because we've added in a little mark. So what is this going to look like when we try to disrupt it? So we have our normal gene. Let me just do this before. Here, we've got a gene that we're interested in making a mutation in it for a regulatory reason. Okay, so that might be our target. What we are going to do is have something where our engineered DNA is going to look similar to this. So we could use region that's homologous to the chromosome. We can have a region that looks a little bit like this exon. And then includes this new bit in the middle of it. And some more of that exon and say that intron. That intron is also going to look like the normal chromosome. So these two are going to look like the normal chromosome. This bit is new, but it looks enough like the normal chromosome that we can get crossovers to happen here and here. And what would happen is that the normal gene here is going to be replaced. So we would have the regulatory region for that gene, which in some ways we don't really care about because we're trying to disrupt the gene. Still included, we're going to have this bit, we're gonna have an intron. If we try to make RNA from this gene, it'll make RNA, but if we try to translate it, it's gonna get stuck here. It's not gonna make the rest of that protein. Okay, so again, that was a lot of stuff. So why don't you take a second, look over your notes, and we'll do some questions. This is a good question. So where is this happening? We're injecting this DNA into those cells. Where is this recombination happening? It's happening in those cells. Yeah, and then we're injecting them into the mouse. Okay, yeah.
So it sounds like, though, in like this case, it's arbitrary whether you choose to put the NEOR before or after the gene that, like, that you're trying to introduce into the.
So here, I mean, we're kind of dropping it right smack in the middle of the gene because we have to put it into an exon if our goal is to inactivate that gene. If we want to disrupt that gene, we're going to put the NEOR right in the middle of the exon. The reason I'm being very emphatic about that is the next thing I'm going to show you is that we're going to put the NEOR in an intron. Okay, so where it goes in the gene matters. It's going to have, so it's going to be one chromosome, so the chromosome is going to be a little bit longer than normal because we put this in. Now, we can also remove part of that exon, so it can be a little bit shorter than normal. But we'll get one continuous chromosome with a swapped out piece of DNA.
How about the piece that we remove?
What happens to the piece that we remove? So typically so this can't be infinitely long, right? It can be a couple thousand bases long, and it turns out that chunks of DNA that are a couple of thousand bases long, if they're not attached to a chromosome, the cell thinks that's just damaged, and it'll degrade it, destroy it. Yeah, so that's actually a good point, that whenever, I think it comes up in a later slide where we just have a diagram, so when you, whatever we engineer, you know, if it's an engineered bit, there's going to be little bits on the end that are going to get cut off too, and those are just going to get degraded. So we're not going to focus too much on what's on the ends. Just assume anything small, the cell takes care of it. Yeah.
When we have like the mouse models, why don't we put the engineered cell back into the original
life? In the original mouse. So the only reason that we do that, it has to do just with making a cell into a mouse. So we could you put it back in the same parents? You could, except then you wouldn't actually know whether the cells got incorporated. So you're doing this pretty amazing in vitro fertilization where you're taking cells from two different embryos and mixing them together into a mouse, and you're hoping that that works. So we need to, if you can imagine this. It's kind of remarkable that you can take a cell from an embryo and put it into a dish and do all sorts of manipulations and then grow a mouse back out of it. It's kind of amazing that that works. And we can do that with human embryos where up to a certain stage we can culture them and then they have to go back into a parent. It's a very challenging procedure. So the reason that we put it in different mouse is that the biology of that is really complicated. So we want to make sure that we actually got our engineered cells into a mouse. Yep.
One last one. So is the engineered DNA, is that going to be the same length as
the. So is the engineered DNA going to be the same length as the same? It really depends on what we're adding and subtracting here. But the thing is that you have to think about the scale of this. So we can manipulate 1,000 or 10,000 bases in a chromosome, but a chromosome has millions and millions of bases long. So you know, not that we can actually see a chromosome, but it's not a big chunk of the chromosome that we're changing here.
Okay.
So the length, if you were, you know, trying to look at a microscope, I would say the length of the normal one might be like this, and the length of the engineered one might be like that. You can't tell the difference. It's a small. The kinds of changes that we can do here are not with what I'm telling you here, are not removing half of a chromosome.
So we're kind of doing recombination with like a shorter.
We're doing recombination. I think maybe one important thing is that we have to do double recombination, right? If only one went in here and it went here, then we break our chromosome. So that would be a problem. It would be definitely shorter. So we need two recombination events.
Okay.
Yeah.
How do you know that recombination is going to happen right there?
How do you know that recombination is going to happen right here and not over here? Yeah, so this is a very good one. There are more sophisticated ways of doing this that involve several different kinds of markers to select. So you have to say it has to include this but not include this. So there are things that you can do in your engineered DNA, which is like, I'm just making that up. So something that if you included this, that would actually be deadly. So you have to include this to live. You have to not include this to not die, and so it'll target it here. But that's actually super complicated, so I won't go into details now.
Why is there a stop code on?
Why is there no stop code? Sorry, maybe I'm not understanding exactly. So the neon cassette is going to have so the regulatory region, and then the DNA that encodes for the neo resistance. At the end of that coding region, it's going to include a stop codon. And so if we've engineered that in. And so that means that if there's, so it's as if we made a mutation that has a stop right there, because we've added in something else that includes the stop. So it's not going to read past that. Is that your question? Like, that's not quite your question.
Why do you need that stop?
Why do you need that? So what we want to do in this particular experiment is make sure that the gene that we put the NEOR into, that gene is disrupted. It doesn't work anymore. And so this is the way that we can guarantee it doesn't work anymore. Yep.
Are we inserting the neomycin resistance at a different part than the other genetic information we're engineering in? Or is this like...
So this is all going to be together. So it's not like the neomycin resistance is somewhere on a different chromosome. This whole piece is together. Is that your question?
Yeah, I was just wondering where, like, for instance, we were talking about coat color. Like, is that assumed in this?
So with the things that we keep track of, so the neomycin is just for part one. Did our cells get the DNA? The coat color is for this other thing of the fact that we start with cells in a dish and we eventually want to make a mouse out of it. So the coat color doesn't tell us, part one is NEOR tells us we have engineered cells. DNA is in our cells. Part two is that those cells contributed to the new baby mouse that we just got. So there's a little bit of a separate thing that we need to test in there. This is like genetic engineering 205. It's pretty intense stuff. Okay, so I think I'll be able to get through this part. We'll stop after this little bit. But this has to do with when we've got a gene knockout. That's what I just went through, which is that we drop. Code that NEOR right in the middle of an exon. Right? So if we have this exon with the NEOR in it, we're basically ensuring that the gene isn't going to work anymore. But maybe we don't want to completely disrupt the gene. Maybe what we want to do is have a gene in which we just change a few amino acids, or even just one amino acid. Maybe there's a disease allele that we found from a GWAS study that changes a valine to a methionine. It's a very small change, and we want to know, does that matter? Okay, so we can't do this kind of trick because we're just going to make that gene completely inactive. What we want to do is make a really subtle change to the gene. So here, what we're going to do is take advantage of another little trick. Okay, so imagine we've got a gene again. Our genes they're all really boring and that they all have regulatory region, they've all got exons, introns, exon 2. And remember, when we make RNA from this, we're going to make RNA like this. And RNA gets processed. So we're going to include, so I'm going to make this RNA look a little bit different when we're on an exon. Just so you can see this. So the processed RNA is going to be all of those exon bits linked together. So this is going to be removed. And this processed RNA is going to be made into protein. So if we can take advantage of this, again, we still have to get that neo-R in there somewhere to tell that, that we got DNA into these cells. But we can target it to an intron. And when we do that, it's sort of living its own life inside of this intron. It's not going to disturb the normal gene, because that little bit is going to get cut out. So what we're going to do here is we're going to target you might say, well, how am I going to make the protein for NeoR? It's an intron. But this is a cool thing about genomes. If we look at the DNA level, we look at that NeoR, what's in there? It's got a regulatory region, and it's got a coding region. So if we just think about the DNA, even though it's hidden inside of here, we can still make RNA from this. Right? So this has got a regulatory region that says, turn on all the time, make this RNA. So this can always make RNA. So from the same DNA, so one piece of DNA here, we're making an RNA for this, and we're making the RNA for that gene. We're just reading the same DNA, RNA polymerase comes and reads off one RNA, and read off the other one. So we can hide things in those introns that are useful for us, but they're not going to disrupt. And that's going to become super useful